everyone. Welcome back to Life on the Prairies, and I am your host, Lindsay Rubinek. And today we are going to speak about how to actually use a labor market impact assessment to your best advantage. And I guess another way of saying it is how you can use an LMIA-based job offer to your best advantage, or how you should really go about pursuing one. So the reason why I'm saying this is because there has been a lot of write-ups recently on the most approved LMIAs, their occupations in 2023. And it's really great information to know. However, I always thought there was something missing. So one day I was thinking of that and I said, you know, this is really great information for temporary foreign workers to understand. However, just knowing what the most occupations approved were in 2023 for labor market impact assessments, or as we call them, LMIAs, right now isn't really good enough. Because if you are paying attention to the immigration scene in Canada, it has become extremely difficult. You know, it doesn't matter if you are someone that's coming here to study and you're thinking that maybe after your studies, you'll apply for a postgraduate work permit and then maybe you will stay. Maybe that's not your intention. Or maybe you are someone that's here on international mobility program and you're here on a work experience and you really like it and you want to stay. It doesn't really matter what pathway you're looking at right now. I will just say it's really, really hard to immigrate to Canada. And maybe you'll find people out there that will say they didn't have a problem or it was pretty easy. But I would like to just state that they are in the minority right now. If you go on to LinkedIn or any social professional platform like that, you will see that there's RCICs such as myself and, yes, my fellow colleagues, as well as lawyers and even newcomers themselves, saying that it is currently really difficult to immigrate to Canada. So with this in mind, I really wanted to talk about the labor market impact assessment, because this is something that is highly utilized and often thought of when temporary foreign workers come to Canada and they decide that they want to immigrate. They usually come here on a labor market impact assessment. Again, not all, because there are different programs available to different people, but there are lots of people who come to Canada based on an LMIA. Now, before we get started, I think it's really important if you're new to the immigration scene in Canada and you don't understand what I'm talking about and you're like, what is a labor market impact assessment? And you've heard people talk about it. I'm just going to briefly go over what it is and its purpose and who delivers it and so on and so forth. At the end of the day, if an employer cannot find a Canadian or permanent resident to fill the position or positions that they need, and there's no other program available for them, then often they turn to what we call a labor market impact assessment. And this can be a very lengthy process for employers and any one of their representatives if they choose to hire one, as it's very technical. So what happens is they have to go through this lengthy process and prove that there was no permanent resident or Canadian that was willing or capable of fulfilling the position or positions that they need filled. So after they apply to Employment Service Development Canada, so let's take note of that too. It's not Immigration Canada that is delivering this program, it's Employment Service Development Canada. So it's a totally different department. And that's the number one thing that people don't realize. So the employer applies to Employment Service Development Canada, which we call ESDC, and they put their application in and they follow all these rules and they have to meet a certain criteria. And if they get a positive response from ESDC, then that will allow them to hire a temporary foreign worker. Because you see, in Canada, we just can't go out and bring people over. There has to either be a program, like a pathway, and there has to be something in place, like a pathway in place for employers to use. You just can't call up someone overseas and say, hey, you know, will you come work in Canada? Because that just doesn't work. So the employer gets a positive confirmation from ESDC, and that is the first part. So this can take anywhere from a couple weeks if you're in the ag sector or global technology sector, or it could actually take a couple months if you are in the low wage or high wage stream. So the timing really depends. So that's the first step. Then the second step is for that person or that employer to find a temporary foreign worker to fill that position. And sometimes people have already identified a temporary foreign worker to fill that position, and oftentimes they have not identified someone. When they do, however, identify someone, they give that confirmation letter, the positive confirmation letter, to the prospective temporary foreign worker. Then that person applies to Immigration, Refugee, and Citizenship Canada. And of course, they include this letter. They include a number of things, you know, such as ties to home country, their travel history. Anyways, there's a whole list that is available on Immigration and Refugee and Citizenship Canada. So we call it IRCC's website. And so the foreign worker applies for the work permit. And this again can take a number of months, and nobody really knows the time frame. And it could be positive, it could be negative. So just because ESDC gave the employer a positive confirmation on the position, it doesn't guarantee that the potential temporary foreign worker that they selected, that they'll automatically get this work permit. But however, if the person does get the work permit, then that allows them to enter Canada and obviously work for the employer. I should also say, if you come from a visa-free country, the person could actually, the temporary foreign worker could show up to the border as long as they had all the paperwork and everything you needed, and present that to the CBSA officer, and then they would decide if you're eligible to come in or not, right? So there's the other way too. I just thought I'd mention that before I get an email from someone stating that, well, there was the visa-free way too, but again, you had to be from a visa-free country and you had to be willing to take that risk to get on the plane or drive to the border and wait for the officer's decision there. Okay, so that is the way how, and in very short, brief, high-level overview, how an LMIA works. It's a two-step process where first the employer gained approval from Employment Service Development Canada, and then the other federal department looks over the work permit, and that is applied by the temporary foreign worker. So it does take a bit of time. So having said all that, as I mentioned at the very beginning, I wanted to take the concept of getting an LMIA one step further, a little bit more strategic, and provide an overview of how important this can be. Now, before we get started with my examples, because I'm going to give you examples of how you can look for an LMIA job offer. Before we get into that, I'm going to give examples of how you can do that and how you can research it. But I kind of just want to really quickly review what were the top 10 most occupations approved that through LMIAs in 2023. And so the first one was general farm workers with 8,239 approvals. Cooks were number two, and it was followed by 5,187. Food service supervisors was 3,739. Food counter attendants was 2,576. Administrative assistants, they were at 1,619 approvals. And retail supervisors, they were at 1,358. Information system analysts were 1,168. Computer programmers, they received 1,133 LMIA approvals. Truck and transport drivers were 1,131 approvals. Construction trades helpers were 994. And the last 10th place was administration officers, which had 990 LMIA approvals. So those were the top 10 occupations that were approved in 2023. So as I said, what I wanted to do a bit differently was look at a couple of these occupations I just mentioned and see if or how they could potentially lead to an immigration strategy. And so there's kind of two thoughts I want to say before we begin this. And the first thing is that an LMIA, when it is provided to a worker, the worker receives a temporary work permit. So an LMIA is not meant to be an immigration pathway, right? It's delivered by Employment Services Development Canada to help the employer overcome short-term employment issues. And obtaining an LMIA and thinking that is going to get you an immigration ticket into Canada is not really something that you should be thinking. It is a possibility. What I do like about LMIAs is that they allow the person to come here and work. And, you know, if you think that Canada is a good fit for you, and if you have a family and you want to bring them over, then yeah, you should look at investigating immigrating here. But I think when you are looking at an LMIA, that perhaps you should look at it as a temporary basis. But if you are thinking that you probably would like to live in Canada, then probably doing what I'm about to say would help you a lot. And secondly, that this is not legal advice, and it should not be construed in any way as legal advice. These are just my thoughts and me talking out loud and just an idea I have. And I really have to reiterate that if you want to take my advice, this is totally on your own doing, and you have to do the research and you have to do what's best for you. There are lots of great representatives, so I strongly recommend that you hire RCIC, a regulated Canadian immigration consultant, or a lawyer that specializes in immigration, and make sure that you go to the CIC website, and I can leave that in my show notes below, and make sure that you hire someone that is regulated or a Canadian lawyer. Do not hire someone that is in your country that has really no connection with Canada. They need to either be a Canadian lawyer or RCIC, and you should ask them for references and so on and so forth. I think I'm going to give you some thoughts about that too when I close my show as well. But anyways, we will get on with it. So those were just my two things I wanted to say before we started. So let's say you are a food supervisor and you have training in that field and you want to look at getting a job in Canada. So what you should do instead of saying, hey, I know this person that lives here, you know, I'm just going to fly there and move to the city and hope for the best and hope I can find an LMIA based job, right? Or, you know, I know these people that live in this province, so that's the only place I'm going to focus because that's where these people live. I really would like for you to take a step back and look at all of Canada. Now, I practice in the Prairie Provinces because that's where my heart is. That's where I feel the best opportunity is. So my examples today are going to be in the Prairie Provinces of Alberta, Saskatchewan, and Manitoba. However, you should always look at every province and see what best suits you. Okay, so you are a food supervisor and you have found that there is opportunity in a couple of provinces for a food supervisor. And so what you should do is you should look at every province's nomination stream, their immigration strategy, what they have, right? And of course, you should also look at the express entry opportunity, that pathway as well, you know, because they have the federal skilled worker, they have the federal trades, and we also have the Canadian experience. And so you could create a profile and set yourself up with that. But if you're someone that, you know, you'll probably need a provincial nomination because your score is lower, and we all know it's very competitive right now, express entry, then you really want to look at the province and what their immigration pathways are. So if we are to look at a food supervisor, which was mentioned in the top 10 when I read them over, and that's tier 65200, I would actually recommend strongly looking at the province of Alberta. And I say this because they actually have a specific stream, and it's the tourism and hospitality stream. And it allows people under this tier to apply for immigration with their employer supporting them. And so what would happen is the person would, you know, accept the LMIA-based position, and then they would work with their employers to seek nomination from the province. Now, that sounds simple, right? But there's a lot more to it. So I think that you should hop on Alberta's, if you are someone that's interested in the tourism and hospitality stream and you have experience in that, then you should really log on to the tourism and hospitality stream in Alberta and really check out the details. because there is a lot of details in it. It's not as easy as what I just said. But let's say, okay, so you accept a food supervisor position, or you are thinking of accepting this food supervisor position in Alberta. The one thing that you will want to do, because not everybody is going to be eligible for this stream just because you are a food supervisor. There are some eligibility requirements, and so I'll quickly go over those just to give you an example of how important it is to research. So at the time of your application, so if you have been there for a while and you want to apply, there are certain things that you are going to have to meet. And so when you're taking a job as a food supervisor with an employer in the province of Alberta, you got to make sure that you are living and working in Alberta in an eligible occupation that is with an approved tourism and hospitality employer. Okay, so that's important too, right? So the employer also has to meet certain requirements, as well as it has to your work permit has to be based on a positive LMIA for the eligible occupation. So what they're saying is that maintained status is not considered a substitute for a valid work permit, and other types of work permits, so such as a post-secondary work permit, would not be eligible. So all they're looking for is somebody that is there working for the employer for 6 months or more, or 780 hours or more, and that employer is a member, but that employee, the temporary foreign worker, actually has a work permit that's based on LMIA. And as I just mentioned, they're going to ask about the work experience. So you have to have a minimum of 6 consecutive months or 780 hours at the time you apply. And it's critical to also know is that at the time you apply and at the time they're assessing you, you have to be in that position. You can't just have, 6 months consecutive work and then not be working for them at the time they assess, because they definitely will be in contact with your employer and they'll ask the employer, like, has this person been paid? Have they worked for you for 6 months, right? So there's all these details that I can go into, but my point being that nowadays it's really hard to just get an LMIA-based job offer and then think, okay, so I got a job offer. I'm, going to work in this province for 6 months to a year and I'm just going to get nominated. That's not the way how it works anymore. And so you really have to be looking at the provinces even before you arrive and just do certain things like that. So it also, just going back to the hospitality and tourism stream, they actually also have examples of who's not eligible. So you got to make sure that when you are accepting these positions that, it even says right in the, when you aren't eligible, it says if you're a seasonal employee. So a lot of people might take a job, an LMIA-based job, and it's seasonal, not realizing that seasonal-based employment, even though it was 30 hours a week and could have been in a 12-month period. But if they mark it as seasonal, then automatically that's not valid. So those are the little intricacies that you should be aware of. And this is why I think going back to hiring someone that is really good in their field, they will know this. They will be your advocate. They will, they aren't going to tell you, no, you shouldn't take it. That's really not what they're there for. What we are here for as RCICs and lawyers and anyone that's going to help you, they're here to make sure you understand that when you're accepting these positions, that here, and if you are interested in immigration, that here are the possible immigration pathways. And if it's, like I said, seasonal, that you won't be eligible for the stream that you think you might have been, right? So it's really important to hire someone that has a really strong understanding and it has your vested interest at heart. Okay, so then the other one I want to also look at is truck and transport or long haul drivers. And I picked this one because in the prairies, we are in so desperate need of long haul truck drivers. And so if I was someone that had truck and transport driving experience, I would definitely be looking again at the prairie provinces because there is a high demand for it. And our cost of living is just, our quality of life, I should say, is second to none. And our cost of living is is so good, right? Like, you know, you can buy a house in Moose Jaw for a quarter of the price of what you could in Toronto. So, and your commute and so on and so forth is so much less, and the quality of life is so much better because you aren't sitting on the highway, the 401, for like 4 hours of traffic. Whereas if you're in a prairie city or community, you are spending 30 minutes driving somewhere with no traffic at all. So anyways, that's my little plug for the prairies. So if I was a truck and transport driver, I would be looking at the prairies. Then I think what would narrow it down is after you have reviewed what, let's say, Alberta has, you look at what Manitoba has, well, then you would look at Saskatchewan and you would see that they actually have their own stream for long haul truck drivers. Now that is very, very exciting news, right? So truck and transport drivers, as I mentioned, was in the top 10. So putting yourself in that position where you are actually going to be obtaining a job where it's high in demand, it has received the, you know, one of the most approvals last year in all of Canada. And then you're strategically placing yourself in a province where they have their own stream for provincial nomination. It just really doesn't get much better than that. And so you can hop on to the province of Saskatchewan, the SINP, and that's the immigration department. And you can look at the subcategory that allows trucking firms to bring long haul truck drivers into Saskatchewan. You know, and it's going to tell you, you must, being a foreign worker, you must begin working for an approved trucking company on a temporary foreign work permit, which would be an LMIA based work permit. And if the approved trucking firm offers a permanent employment, then you would be able to apply to the SINP in conjunction with your employer, because Saskatchewan does require the employer to go through a couple steps. So you need to ensure that your employer is willing to do this. You just can't assume that, you know, even because there's a stream, that you're automatically going to be supported by your employer. You need to speak with your employer and ensure that after you work 6 months, 780 hours of full-time, 30 plus hours a week, that, you know, they're going to strongly consider providing you a job approval letter that is supported by an LMIA, and they're going to be in support of this, right? You also must be sure that you have a Saskatchewan Class 1A driver's license, and you have that full-time permanent job offer. And as well as, you know, these are the little things that people overlook. You should have, well, it says you must have a Canadian language benchmark of 4, right? So these are all the little things that when you are looking for a job in Canada through an LMIA, that you just got to spend some time doing. Immigration is up to you. In the most part of everything, it is up to you. To leave it to someone else is not being very responsible. You know, yes, as I keep saying, you should hire, a well-respected, a good RCIC or a lawyer. You should have those people in your, you know, backing you up and supporting you and guiding you through these streams. However, it is up to you to make sure that you understand it. It is up to you to make sure that you meet the language requirements, that you have the proper licensing. Like, we cannot do that for you. So those are the things that you really need to do your homework on. And if you do your homework and you identify the position that you're eligible for, you're successful in that position, and you research their province and the nomination streams, you know, when you go to apply for immigration, it's just going to be that much easier on you. And if you have a family and your costs won't be as high, you know, it's just going to be an all-around win-win situation, because everybody knows that immigration can be very stressful. So if you want to know more about the long haul category, then please hop on to the SINP and you'll find it. It'll be right there on their website. I did want to look at Manitoba, but I'm going to actually use them in a different light. So I'm going to tell you what happens and where things go wrong if you choose one province before another. let's say that you receive a job offer as a computer and information systems manager, which was in the top 10 most approved LMIAs in Canada in 2023. So that's tier 20012. Now, let's say you have accepted it and you are in the province of Ontario and you realize that you are not going to get nominated. It's just, you know, too competitive and so on and so forth. And you actually have people that are living in Manitoba, you know, people. So they tell you to come on to Manitoba and they line up a job and it's an LMIA based job. And they say, okay, so I got a friend who actually has an approved LMIA and they're willing to give it to you. And you come to Manitoba. So this is my home province. Well, here's going to be the problem. Right now, the province of Manitoba is drawing skilled worker in Manitoba around 840 points. So you will come here and as a computer information systems manager, you will probably have a degree, you will probably have really good work experience, you will have probably great communication, either English or French, right? So you're going to check all those boxes and you're probably going to have a really high mark and you're probably going to be competitive to get a nomination that is, you know, between 800 and 850, which we're currently drawing on. Now, here is the thing. So Manitoba actually deducts points if you and or your spouse has worked or studied in another province. So when you come from Ontario or wherever you've been because you realize you are not going to get a nomination and you come to the province of Manitoba and you have a score of, let's say, 837, there will automatically be 100 points deducted from you. So your points will actually be 737. So this does not make you competitive currently for the skilled worker in Manitoba. Moral of this story is that you, if you are looking at a province like Manitoba, where I have to say our housing is very affordable, great outdoor lifestyle, lots of recreation, you know, this should probably be your first stop if you are considering Manitoba or if you have a job offer here. And let's say, you know, you have two job offers and one's in British Columbia and one's in Manitoba. I have had a lot of clients from British Columbia wanting to move to Manitoba because unfortunately the cost of living is very high, specifically in the Lower Mainland region where my clients are all from. And so though I have to explain to them because oftentimes they've come over here with another representative and that representative has convinced them to live and work and study in that province, in the high populated region. And they want to move because they cannot make it there. However, you know, since they've studied and worked there, they automatically get 200 points deducted when they come to Manitoba. So we then have to look at, is it worth it? Will there actually be even opportunity in terms of a nomination for them to come, right? So that's my moral of this story for the province of Manitoba. Not specifically the province of Manitoba, but it's really important to recognize that there might be penalties from other provinces if you have lived in another province. That's just because they want to understand and they want to know that you are committed to living and working in their province, because every province wants you to stay and work there because, of course, when you work there, you pay taxes, you buy houses. So when a province nominates you, it's to their benefit that you stay there. And if you come from another province, then they do have the right to question your commitment and your loyalty to that province. So that's just a warning for those people who are just, you know, saying, okay, well, I'll get a LMIA based job in this province. And then if this doesn't work out, I'm going to go here. And if this doesn't work out, I'm going to go here. Or if you get a seasonal based LMIA, is it something that's really going to help you with the immigration at the end of the day? So these are so many things you have to consider when you are looking for an LMIA based job opportunity. There's just a ton. Just please do your research and understand that obtaining an LMIA job opportunity, accepting it, is not a guarantee of an immigration pathway. However, you can help yourself by doing the research before you accept that job and even before arriving in Canada, just so you have the best options and save yourself a lot of money, time, and heartache. Just before I go, I want to touch on LMIAs and the employer's responsibilities. And there's a lot of responsibilities with an employer, and it really depends on the stream that you come under. But, you know, I want everybody to know that it is highly illegal and unethical for any employer to charge you any amount of money to get a job. So if somebody has charged you amount of money to get a job, you know, it'd be at $1,000 or $50,000, and they're telling you that if you don't stay with them, or if they're threatening you in any way, if they're threatening you saying, well, we will send you back to whatever country, do not listen to them. You have rights and you need to log on to ESDC and IRCC, and there's some helpful information that will guide you, and I'll also put that in my show notes. And you are not obligated to stay with a representative that may be charging you outrageous fees. So let's say that you have paid a representative, a lawyer, or RCIC a lot of money, and they're telling you that, you know, I got you here, and you have to stay with me now. You cannot break this contract. Yes, you can. You can break that contract. You are a client. You are not obligated to pay that amount. You can go ahead and go on the CIC website, go find a new representative. You can represent yourself, although I don't really recommend that, but you can do that. But find yourself somebody that's loyal, that's respected, and that's very trustworthy. As well, know that nobody can send you back to your country. The only people that can, the only department that can, is Immigration, Refugee, and Citizenship Canada. So your employer can't send you back. If there is a problem, though, with employer-employee-based relationship and they do let you go and your work permit is restricted, you may be out of options. There may be other options to get another LMIA-based position, but you don't have to. They don't govern what you can do. It's Immigration, Refugee, and Citizenship Canada. So I strongly encourage you to read all about your rights as a foreign worker. Okay, so having said all of that, I really want to thank you all so much for listening to this podcast and taking time to learn more about the importance of LMIA jobs, the location of where your job may be, and what, if any, provincial strategy would actually or could assist you to attain your permanent residency if that is really what you are looking for. If you have any more questions, you can always feel free to reach out to me, Lindsay, at immigration@100meridian.ca or WhatsApp. And I'll also have that in my show notes. So until next time, I hope everyone lives rural, live well.
And I will roam these dusty country roads, been searching all this time, and I think I'm